we actually know something. Thank you, Kevin. Announcements, I'm sorry. Announcements we have, we had a card of thanks from the Torres family. Mia Jordan was born this past week, and she was here this morning, her first time. We're glad to see her. We congratulate Caleb and Amy on the birth of her. And 8 pounds, 3 ounces, 20 inches long, and she seems to be doing well. Grandma thinks she's doing well, I think. That's another color you're looking at by two, our puzzle. I met Miss Carol over at Ozzy's the other day. She was having to buy stuff for the rest of the kids. Let's bring the nursing home service. Everybody possible can be there, next Sunday, 2 o'clock at the Richmond Hill Nursing Home. Everybody's got to be out of town next weekend, and it's just a fact of scheduling. But Kevin and Mark said they would be there, and they're going to be there, so we need some people to be there to support them, please. At the men's meeting today at 4:30, the men's will be posted shortly. And November Bible readings are in the foyer. Appreciate the comments from this morning's lesson. Always appreciate the comments, and hope that we'll be benefited by the things that we say. Tonight, we're going to talk about preparing to meet God. That's why Kevin was trying to read the song for us. Amos 4:12, God told his people through the prophet, "Therefore thus will I do unto thee, O Israel. And because I will do this unto thee, prepare to meet thy God, O Israel." The Israelites of long ago, from time to time, were disobedient to God. And you can go back as far as the book of Judges. Actually, go back to the book of Joshua. There they were in the land. They were supposed to be doing certain things. They failed to do everything that God asked them to do. You can go back a little bit further, quite a bit further, I guess you could say, to the time when they left Egypt. God showed them that he was all-powerful. He showed the Egyptians he was all-powerful. He showed his power to his people. They get out in the wilderness, and they're afraid they're going to die of thirst. And then they're going to die for lack of food. And God takes care of them. He told them he would. And then as we get further into their history, we find where time and time again, they chose to give up on God and rather to worship idols and to disobey God's commands. Well, tonight, let's look at this. As God warned the Israelite, he warns man today. I just wrote an article yesterday, I think it was, for the newspaper a couple weeks from now, and this is one of the things I put in there. God dealt with the Israelites of old, and we have those things as lessons for us, so we can learn by those things. But how many times do we fail to see the lesson that's there and to obey God as he would have us to obey? Well, we think about this. Romans 14:12, so that every one of us will give account of himself to God. That's something we've got to take personally. You know, sometimes I think people get caught up in the idea of religion and they don't remember to understand that, yes, we gather as a church family. Now, I love the church family, but we've each individual have got to realize we'll stand before God. I'm not going to be judged by the things that you do. You're not going to be judged by the things I do, but I'll be judged by what I've done. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10, Paul wrote these words. He said, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ." You know, as of yet in my lifetime, I've never had to go before a judge, to my knowledge, for anything that I've done or not done. But I've been to court with some other people. And even being there with other people, and even over minor things, it was still kind of a nerve-wracking experience because you just didn't know what was going to happen. But we're all going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ. As we appear before the Lord, we're going to know that it's based on what I've done. And our idea, the idea of our memory, is still going to be there. And we'll know what we've done and what we've not done. He said that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. There's just no way around it. It'll be whether you've done good or bad. And it's too late to change things. That's why it's so important that we look to God's word and follow it. As I think about that, I know that there are those who say, "Well, you know, see what it says, but we don't need to go there. If this is what it says do, if this is how God said it's to be done, then period. That's it. That's what we've got to do. We're not going to live in this world forever. This world will be destroyed one day. Peter tells that in 2 Peter chapter 3, beginning verse 10. Just before that, he said God's not slack concerning his appointment. His promises that some men got slackness, but his long-suffering usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And knowing that that's what he wants, and knowing that the world's going to be destroyed later on in that passage, down about verse 10 or so, he's going to say, knowing this, what manner of life ought we to live? And that's what we need to think about. What kind of life do I need to live? But God warned the Israelites of old, and he warns us today. Revelation 20 and 12, therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea. For the devil has come down, and he can have a great wrath, because he knoweth he hath but a short time. Now, I know people say, well, you know, the devil's just a figment of some preacher's imagination. No, he's not. I'm always amazed when I listen to those people, because they figure on going to heaven. So that means they believe that there's a spirit being called God. But you need to understand, while Satan doesn't have power to control us as he would like to have, he's a real being. As God's word says, as he himself said, we are to be watchful of him as he's a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour. That's why it's so important that we listen to the warnings that are given. We need to prepare to meet God. I hope that everyone here this evening is prepared to meet God. If you died this evening, or if the Lord came back right now, we'd be ready to go and stand before that bar of judgment. Well, these five words suggest some interesting questions, important questions. First of all, why prepare to meet God? Secondly, when to prepare to meet God? And thirdly, how to prepare to meet God? You know, in these three questions, the why we've already begin to talk about it a little bit, we'll discuss it a little bit further. The when, we've got to realize, is the time and opportunity we have. We're not always going to have the opportunities that we have right now. That's why we have to take advantage of it. You know, if I told you, if you come down here tomorrow at 9 o'clock in the morning, I'll give you a $10,000 bill, if there is such a thing. I've never seen one. How many would take off work to be here to get $10,000? Well, if we put it in the newspaper, I believe we'd have a lot of people out on the road or further waiting to get $10,000. Well, we're giving away something far more valuable than $10,000. The Lord has given us the means whereby we can go to heaven. And so we ought to be interested in how to prepare to meet God. So let's begin our thoughts together. Why should a person prepare to meet God? Well, first of all, God commands it. And who are we to defy what God says? God says that we're to be ready. Ready at all times. You know, some Christians seem to have the idea that they can take a day off now and again and not be a Christian. I'm always reminded when I hear that. I think it's a Geico commercial of a parent who walks in and looks down at the little toddler and says, I need the day off. I've got a cold and I'm sick. But we don't get days off as parents, do we? You have to work. Even when you get older, it doesn't tell you still have to work. Well, that's part of being a parent. And we decided we wanted to do that. Well, friends, we can't take a day off from being a child of God. We've got to be a child of God every day. There are so many people who see us, and we're not an island to ourselves. There are people who see us at work. There are people who see you in school, young people. There are people who see us in our neighborhoods. You see, God says we need to be prepared. There's a lot of reasons for that. But the main reason we're going to think about first is, who are we to defy God? In Acts 17:30-31, the Apostle Paul, he's recorded here by Luke, he said, the times of his ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. And notice this, because he hath appointed a day. That day is very important. That's the day of judgment, in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, where he hath given assurance unto all men, and that he raised him from the dead. To prove that he is the one who's going to judge us, he was raised from the dead. He came forth triumphant. He's our hope of the resurrection. Friends, we've got to prepare to meet God. God commands this. God wants us to go to heaven. He wants us to be able to live in eternity with him. But again, it's up to us to make that decision. We need to prepare to meet God. the condition that we're in today. You know, I deal with sickness and health myself and other people from time to time, and certain conditions mean certain things. You know, I've been with cancer patients, and the doctor tells them, under no circumstances are you to go out in a crowd of people at all. And they want to come to worship service so bad, but the doctor's told them, you just simply can't do it right now. Your immune system is too weakened. You see, our condition of being sinners demands that we prepare to meet God. Those cancer patients do what the doctor said, because they're trying to live. Well, if we want to live eternally, we've got to be prepared. Our condition demands that we do it. The prophet Isaiah 59:1-2, he said, behold, the Lord's hand is not short that it cannot save, neither is ear heavy that it cannot hear. Here's the problem. But your iniquities and your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, and he will not hear. You see, there's not a perfect person in the world. Jesus was the only perfect one who walked upon the face of the earth. And being perfect, he was the Son of God. He didn't sin. But you see, we sin and fall short. We sin. We come to this world. You know, little Jordan was here this morning. She is so precious. And we can all remember our own children when they were born and how precious they were. And no sin whatsoever. But as we get older, we sin. We sin, and because of that, we have to be justified. We have to be redeemed. And we have no way of doing that by ourselves. God has given the way whereby we can be redeemed, and that's Christ. We talked about him this morning. Well, friends, our condition demands that we be prepared to meet God. In John chapter 3, remember when Nicodemus came to Jesus, and he said, asked him some questions, and he said, Jesus told him in verse 3 through 5, he said, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time in his mother's womb and be born? Notice Jesus what he says. He says, verily I say unto thee, except a man be born of the water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Nicodemus was a smart man. He was a smart man in his religion. He knew, and he just told Jesus before this, they knew he was a man from God. He wanted to know what to do because Nicodemus realized he needed salvation also. Our condition of being sinners demands that we prepare to meet God. Well, unless we know Christ, we need to understand that we'll be punished with everlasting destruction. I don't like to think about that. I remember as a young person, not a Christian, I spent some sleepless nights thinking about that. And then as a wayward Christian, I began to think about it again. I don't want to spend eternity in hell. I don't really know anybody who truly does. I've had a couple of people tell me they knew they were going to hell and they were okay with that. I think they really just don't believe in hell. I've been through some painful things. You know, recently with this hearing things, when I tell y'all what they've been doing to me, I see y'all's faces. Y'all think that's the worst thing in the world could ever happen to you. It's not that bad. But hell's going to be that bad. I've seen people in such pain they were really could bust their teeth open, really, because they were gnashing their teeth together. They were in so much pain. I've seen people have to take so much medicine they didn't want to take because they were in pain. That pain doesn't even begin to tell us what hell's going to be like. If we don't know Christ, if we're not a child of God, if we're not living a faithful life, we have to realize eternal punishment's waiting for us. We look at the Bible about this in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Again, Paul was the writer here to the Thessalonian brethren. He said, and then asked some questions about those that gone on before. He said, and ye are troubled, rest with us, when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them. And notice, taking vengeance on them that know not of God and that obey not the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the Lord's power. We like to believe in the love of God. We like to believe in heaven. We like to believe about the comfort and peace that God can give us. Of how heaven will be with no sickness or sorrow or dying. We have to think about that. But this is part of it too. That's why we've got to be prepared. We've got to be prepared to meet God. The The song says, careless soul, why do you linger, wandering from the fold of God? Hear ye not the earnest pleadings, oh, prepare to meet thy God. Friends, we've got to be prepared. We've got to take it seriously. Every day, every hour, we've got to be prepared. Our eternal happiness depends upon us preparing to meet God. We think about what Jesus said here in John 14. We looked at this passage this morning. When he said, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If we're not so, we'll tell you. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. If I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you myself. And where I am, there will be me also. Whether I go to know the way, you know. You see, he wants us to be in heaven with him. He wants us to be part of that throng that we read about in Revelation, around the throne of God, praising God day and night. That's what God wants. That's what Jesus wants. That's what the Spirit wants. But if we're not prepared, we're not going to spend eternity with God. We'll spend eternity in a place that's prepared for the devil and his angels. We've got to be prepared. Well, the Bible tells us heaven is a place of no tears in Revelation 21, 3 and 4. I hear people sometimes say, yes, but you know, I just don't understand how that can be. God says it's going to be. He said, I heard a voice, John said, I heard a voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He will dwell with them. They shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any pain, for the former things have passed away. You see, we're all going to spend eternity somewhere. We're all going to be there. I don't care. You may die before the Lord comes back. But when the Lord comes back, there'll be a resurrection, either to heaven or damnation. That's why we're going to be prepared. We'll go to a place, we'll be a place where there are no tears, where there's no suffering. We were talking about the men's meeting tonight, another shooting today in a church out in Texas or somewhere. I don't remember exactly where it was now. It's terrible. It's terrible when we live in a world where that could happen. But you don't have a fine meeting place like that. We don't have to worry about somebody coming in to take us out. We want to meet with God. We've got to prepare. Well, secondly, when should we prepare? When should we prepare to meet God? We've had that. I posed this question before to a lot of people. I have a lot of answers. Well, you know, I want to get my life straight before I make another score. I want to get my life straight before I come back to God. And I always tell the person I'm talking with, you don't understand God, do you? You see, you come to God, you listen to what his teachings are, and you obey God, then you've got help in overcoming those things that are keeping you from obeying and keeping you from living a faithful life. If you can do it on your own, why did Christ come? You need to understand that. The time to prepare is now. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 2. Again, Paul was the writer here. He said, for he saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted, the day of salvation, I have succored thee. He said, behold, now. Now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. In that verse, we need to understand that he's telling us by what we need to do. Now, you can think of a thousand reasons why not to obey the gospel, but you can't think of one good one. Well, you know, I want so-and-so to see me be baptized. Well, you want to see you in hell if you die before that happens. Well, I want to think about it a little more. How long are you going to think about it? What do you got to think about it? God's offering salvation. The devil's offering a place of destruction. What do you got to think about it? Well, now, I've had some people tell me that, well, you know, I'm kind of afraid of water. Well, if I do it, I'm a pretty good-sized fellow. I haven't lost anybody yet. Now, I can't say that there are no preachers who haven't lost anybody. A fellow I used to work with up in Memphis when I was in school, he worked in northern Michigan, and it was cold, he said. It was really cold. And they only had a stream that was running water. The water was swift. It hadn't even froze over. And this woman was so afraid of being baptized. She was afraid of water. He said, don't worry. I got you. And he said, he put her down. When he put her down, she took off. They had to go downstream and catch her. But this is still water here. We want See, God wants you to become his child. Now, I'll be honest with you, I used to be afraid of water. First person I baptized, they had to come all the way back to the wall with me because I was afraid to get away from the wall, afraid they'd fall in the water and drown. Of course, it didn't help that the boots were filled up with water while I was standing there, and I was just even water myself anyway. But you see, the point is now. That's when we need to prepare. Hebrews chapter 3. And by the way, we have more of the lectureship books, and if you didn't get one, you need to. If you want to study the book of Hebrews, the men did a great job. It was a great job, the lessons they presented in the book itself. But the point we're talking about tonight is, when does someone need to obey the gospel? The Hebrew writer says, wherefore, as the Holy Ghost said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation, in the day of temptation in the wilderness. You recall Hebrews 3 talks about what happened, how because of unbelief they hardened their hearts and they weren't able to go into the rest. Chapter 4 begins by telling us not to let that happen to the Hebrew Christians there, but by application to us. Don't let that happen. If you keep putting off obeying the gospel, your heart can get hard and you won't ever obey. Because the Word of God won't be able to touch you. You're a child of God, you're not living, you're not prepared to die and go home to heaven. Quit saying no to coming back to the Lord. Come back to the Lord. Thus your heart gets as hard as it's supposed to. The when is now is when we need to prepare. You think about this, young or old, now's the time. You know, I've heard young people say, I told you before, this lady in Kentucky, she told her son, you don't even think about obeying the gospel if you get to be an adult, just go and sow your wild oats. Well, I'm 60 years old, and he's a year older than I am, and he's still sowing wild oats. He never obeyed the gospel because she didn't tell him to take the time to study God's word, didn't sit down with him, or wouldn't let him listen. You see, I'm sure now she wishes she'd changed her mind. Ecclesiastes 12, verse 1, he says, remember now thy creator of the days of thy youth. While the evil days come not, and the years draw nigh, and thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in it. Age is coming to everyone if you live long enough, isn't it? Now's the time, young or old. Don't think because you're young, you don't have to worry about this, be concerned about your soul, because you do. We have no promise of the next minute, much less the next year or hour or whatever. We may die or we may come back. The when is now that we need to prepare. Well, why should it be now? James chapter 4 tells us. He said, go to you now and say today and tomorrow you shall go in such a city, continue there a year, and buy and sell and get gain. He says, whereas you know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and passeth away. I got an alert on my phone while I go, there's supposed to be patchy fog in the morning. Well, that fog illustrates what the inspired writer is telling us here. That fog won't last all day, it'll be gone. And young folks, I know y'all don't believe this, but that's what life's like. Before long, you look back and say, where did life go? Well, we need to obey God. We need to prepare right now. Well, consider these reasons for preparing now. You cannot live life the way it should be without Christ. A lot of people don't see that. You're not going to get the enjoyment out of life if Christ is not in your life that you could have. That doesn't say you're going to be a millionaire. That doesn't say you're going to get a lot of glory and fame. It says you can have a life that will be thoroughly enjoyable because you know the Lord is yours and you're the Lord's. And life will be everything you need. You'll suffer problems and burdens just like everybody else, but you have someone to give. You have God to give to. Not only that, you need to exert the best influence possible on those you love. To me, this reason right here, you're not a child of God. What are you saying to your wife? What are you saying to your husband or to your children? You know, I think about fathers in the Bible. Abraham, God knew him, how he would conduct his children, Genesis 18:19. Now think about Lot. And all Lot thought about was the well-watered plains of the Jordan, how it would benefit him. And where did he end up? Sitting as a judge at the city of Sodom. What happened there? The city was destroyed. Think about the influence. The influence we need to have on our families. On our children, our grandchildren, our nieces, our nephews. Be prepared to meet God. And we need to be ready to die at any time. Because whether we like to realize it or not, I know people don't like to talk about death, but death is part of life. It's just a part of life. If we're prepared to meet God, it's part of life that we can go through. It won't be that bad. Think about families. How's your family going to feel if you're not a Christian? If you're not a Christian, leave this life. But they know you knew what to do. They know you needed to. They pled with you. They begged you, but you wouldn't do it. And now they're going to have to sit there and think, oh, I wish they could live in gospel. What an influence we can be on our family and friends. Well, how does a person prepare to meet God? Life by the Word of God is the only way. It's the only way. We've got to follow what God says. Psalm 119, verse 9. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereunto according to thy word. The Word of God is what tells us how we need to obey God, how we need to live our life. We need to prepare to do that. Well, we have to do some things first. The alien sinner, the one who's never obeyed the gospel, has to believe. Hebrews 11, 6, a verse we're familiar with. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh from God must believe that he is. He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Believing in God, believing in Christ as the Son of God, is a vital part of our faith. If we don't believe that, then we can't have faith. If we can't have faith, we can't obey the gospel. So faith is necessary. Faith is necessary. John 8, 24, Jesus said, I say unto you that you shall die in your sins. For if you believe not that I am he, you shall die in your sins. Believing in Christ as the Son of God. Believing he's the one, the Savior. In John 20, 30 and 31, the Bible was written so that we could have these things. It says there are many other signs truly that Jesus was present as disciples, which are not written in these books, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and believing you might have life through his name. It's only through Christ we're going to get to heaven. We have to believe in him as he's the Son of God. Repentance. Repentance is something that must occur. Luke 13, 3 and again, verse 5, Jesus said there, I tell you, nay, but except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. Some people want to leave repentance out of obeying the gospel. They put more emphasis on baptism than do repentance. You can't put more emphasis on any of those steps than you do all of them. Because repentance is necessary. If you're doing something contrary to God's will and you don't repent of it, you can be baptized, but it's not going to happen. You have to turn from those things. You have to turn to God. In Acts 17, 30 and 31, I think we looked at this passage this morning also. In the times of his ignorance, God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to do what? To repent. Because he hath appointed a day which shall judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, where he hath given assurance unto all men that he hath raised him from the dead. We looked at it a while ago too, didn't we? You see, repentance is necessary. It's how we do it. Why do we do it this way? This is what God said. This is what he said in his word. We have to confess. Confess the name of Christ. Acts 8:37. You recall Philip and Ethiopian Bobby. I tell you what, I wish y'all could sit up here with me sometime and listen to how these young people, especially the little ones, talk, pronounce some of these names. It brings a smile to your face. The Ethiopian eunuch is one that gives them a lot of trouble. But that's who Philip was talking to. He said, thou believest with all thine heart thou mayest. And he said, I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. He was willing to confess the name of Christ. In Romans 10, 9 and 10, he says, thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him, then thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now remember, he's saying unto salvation. Salvation doesn't occur when we confess. Well, then we have to be baptized. Now, we're going to get around to that because that's part of God's plan. Mark 16, 15 and 16, Jesus talking there, he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. That's that destruction that we're talking about. We need to prepare to meet God. The how is by obeying the gospel of Christ. Again, Acts 2:38, we looked at that this morning too on the day of Pentecost. That's what Peter told those people. When they stopped him and said, what can we do? He said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And that other passage we looked at this morning, Acts 22, 16. And Ananias had been preaching to Saul, telling him the way of the Lord more perfectly. He said, now why tarriest thou? Arise, be baptized, and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. That's the how. how can the fallen? How can the fallen come back to God? You've got to come back home. You got to come back home. You got to repent of those things. Acts 8:22, repent therefore of this thy witness and pray God, and even the thought of thy heart might be forgiven. That's difficult for some people to do. I've known people who were out of duty with the Lord for years. And suddenly, just one Sunday, they decide to come back and sit down and just act like everything's fine, but they never, never repent of what they know. May go on for years. But you see, you have to repent. You have to ask for God's forgiveness of these things. Well, Revelation 3 and verse 2, be watchful and strengthen the things which remain, and be ready to die, for I am not found thy works perfect before God. You see, God knows about every one of us. He knows whether or not we're faithful children of God or not. He knows whether we need to repent or not. He wants us to repent. We have to be prepared. Well, we've covered the why, when, and how to meet God. And the idea is we need to prepare to meet God today, not on another day. Prepare to meet thy God. Sometimes read the words of the psalm we sing from time to time. Understand, as you sing that song, a man wrote those words, but God wrote the words in Amos, who told his people, prepare me.